people want to pray, there's, you know, people are just gathering to pray. And if people want to know what's the closest location for them to gather in person, you can go to the nationaldayofprayer.org. That's the website, /events.
And welcome back to another wonderful Wednesday night as we gather together to be able to pray and intercede here at Lion of Judah. Our Wednesday evening prayer meeting has become this online event that has sort of sustained itself even after most of this COVID thing is done. And I'm so grateful to have Charlotte here with me. Charlotte, just greet our folk and give a welcome, dear.
We are so delighted to be again with you on this Wednesday evening. And we just appreciate so much. We've been hearing just some wonderful feedback on how much these Wednesdays have meant to you. We've had so many special guests, and we thank God for them and for what God is doing. And this has been a week where we've really been super saturated, I'd say, in prayer, Brent. We are part of the global family, 24/7 prayer room, and we were involved in a one miracle night, which was a 24-hour long prayer for several Muslim cities throughout the world as the Muslim people celebrated the highlight, their holy night at the end of Ramadan. And our hearts have been really challenged like never before to really press in and believe the Lord for salvation for the Muslim people. We heard wonderful reports of what God is doing in so many of these countries where Christians are persecuted and really go through the trial of their faith in ways that we as Americans have not had to experience. And so we just are so thankful for what God is doing throughout the world, that He is revealing Himself and just coming in visions and dreams. We hear this all the time in the Muslim world. So let's just keep pressing in to prayer. And we're going to hear more about prayer in this program too tonight.
We sure are. And for those of you who are aware of the fact that we've been very involved with the National Day of Prayer, and particularly with our friend Angelo Rajadurai. And we're going to have him just in a minute come into our program. He's waiting in the wings on Zoom. Zoom is the kind of the catch-all for everybody for all kind of businesses and all kinds of activities. But I'm going to read the scriptures that the National Day of Prayer has made as their focal scriptures for this year. And it's Colossians chapter 2, and it's verses 6 and 7. And I'm reading from the New King James Version of the Bible here today. "And you, therefore, have received Jesus Christ, the Lord. So walk in Him, rooted and built up in Him, and established in the faith, as you have been taught, abounding with it, with thanksgiving." And you know, Angelo, it's so good to have you. We just welcome you, and we're grateful for you being here again. Actually, for this National Day of Prayer, for the last couple of years, it seemed like we kind of were, you know, Grand Central Station around the studio, and you were here in person, and yet you've got so many things that are going on, and with COVID being kind of released and loosed and not being in bondage to that as much anymore, there's so many opportunities now for people to do things and go into live expressions of prayer across this state of Massachusetts in particular. And so I'm just going to turn it over to you to begin to describe and to talk a little bit, maybe reminisce with me a little bit about some of the things that God has done in the past, because He's really brought a real bonding in our relationship and our friendship. But there's just wonderful things to look forward to. So, Angelo, take it away.
Brent, thank you so much for inviting me for this call and this event and this recording. And I'm so glad that you invited us and invited me, and you know, you guys, both of you, Brandon and Charlotte, you with open arms kind of welcome me into your family. I really feel part of your family now, and you know, it's the blessing of God. And I remember the first time we did it. I'm not sure, Brandon, you remember, and Charlotte, I'm sure you do, because you were the one that did all the heavy lifting.
Yes.
I think
yes.
A week before or 2 weeks before National Day of Prayer.
Two weeks before.
I didn't know who you were. Pastor Dave Hill kind of introduced us, and we were supposed to do a 30-minute event in the afternoon, just us, something like this. And then it ended up being a whole day event, and I think we're supposed to finish at 5. We were struggling to close it at 6. Yes. We had music. We had about, I think, 70 people who came, you know, and we had the mayor there, you know, it was Superintendent Casilius was there, and, you know, it was just amazing. And at the end of the day, I was in tears. It was just so beautiful how God moved. And ever since, I think I feel like I'm part of your family, you know. So I thank you all so much. And even after that, it's been beautiful to get together with you and pray, you know, the Friday prayers that we've been having, and it's been wonderful. And, you know, and even last year, even though it wasn't grand, I'm not sure, Brand, I told you, we looked at the Facebook posting of the first event. And if I remember right, we had 6,000 views on Facebook.
Wow. Wow.
That was, you know, that's in Massachusetts, you know.
Yeah.
So I praise and thank God, right? You know, I was looking for the 1,000 more so that I can tell with Elijah there are 7,000 people that are not bowed their knees to Baal, you know. Uh-huh. So, yeah. So I'm sure, and, you know, and it's kind of morphed and grown over time. And this year, the focus has become more, you know, boots on the ground. And there's something to say for that too, mm-hmm. right? You know, being able yeah. to present and, you know, and I've not done much. I feel like God has taken over. And, you know, like this theme here, you know, exalt the Lord who has established us, right? It's really nothing, you know, and I was telling somebody this morning, I've got a front row seat on what God is doing, right? It looks like I'm not involved. God is just moving and, you know, in the hearts and minds of people to gather together and pray. You know, I think there is a need, but also I feel the 2 years ago, there was a real cry for a need for prayer. But what I'm seeing now is almost a joyful expression of prayer. It's almost like, Lord, you've done something for us. You know, you throughout this time, you've done something for us. Enough of asking you for things. We want to exalt you. You know, you've done it, you know, and we are just basking in what God is doing around us. I'm sure you're feeling the same thing. You know, you're speaking to more people. I know the events that you've said you've been recently in, it seems like the atmosphere is changing from, you know, us saying, oh, we are the frozen chosen and things like that, to being a place where we're seeing God move, and all we want to do is just lift our hands and, you know, exalt Him. You know, I really feel that's the change that's going on. You know, Brand, I'm sure you feel the same way too.
Charlotte, yeah, it is really true. You know, there is just so much that is happening, and as we just participate with the Lord, unbelievable things begin to just take over and just happen. I mean, what Charlotte was referring to, what we were doing this at the end of this past week, was we were praying with this global family prayer room that has been started up. And I know that Jonathan Frizz was involved at least heavily in the very beginnings of it. It seems like Jason Hubbard is now more kind of leading the way in that on things sort of internationally. But God really has done something amazing. We had in our prayer hour, which is from 6 to 7 in the morning, there were over 40 people that were on Zoom with us praying. And then along with that, it was being, you know, streamed over YouTube. And I don't know how many people were on that. I'll have to check that just to kind of see statistically. But there is something of an undergirding in prayer that is just really beginning to happen. And it's at a very, very deep level. You know, Charlotte and Michelle and some of the other ladies meet here, and we just want to tell our Lion of Judah people who are watching that they meet every Wednesday, and they meet from 1 o'clock until about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and they're just up on the fourth floor just praying and seeking the Lord in person.
And it's not just ladies now. We have men joining us as well. So it's growing.
Well, tell us a little bit about that, Charlotte, just to kind of bring that into the picture as well, because we do want for our people here at Lion of Judah to know that there are many things that they can participate in.
Yes, it's been almost 2 years now. Michelle had this burden on her heart for a house of prayer here in Boston, which we call Firebrand House of Prayer. And so on Wednesdays we meet, as you said, Brant, from 1 to 3, and we overlook the city of Boston, the magnificent view of the city on the fourth floor of Lion of Judah, and we pray specifically for the city of Boston. We pray as well for the nation, but primarily for Boston, to see a real move of God, a real awakening in Boston, in the governmental sphere, the educational sphere, the church sphere, and God meets us there. It's been very, very special.
Well, you know, even as we are talking about prayer, and this is our prayer meeting, it just makes sense that we just have a little round of prayer. And then I know, Angelo, we've got more that we're going to be discussing about some of these different places that people can participate and can gather together in person now. So, Angelo, why don't you lead this first portion in prayer, and then Charlotte, if you would just pick it up from there, and then I'll kind of wrap it up.
Father, we are so grateful to you. We come before you, Lord, with such a joy. Lord, your word says in your presence there is fullness of joy. Lord, and we just, as soon as we come into your presence, as soon as we get together with the people of God, it's just joyful. Lord, what a wonderful God you are. Lord, your joy is our strength. And even this evening, Lord, we are so grateful, Lord, that you've given us brothers and sisters whom together we can join and talk about the length and breadth and height and width about the love of God. And we are just enjoying your presence, Lord. We want to exalt you. Lord, we know there is many needs, right? There's time for that prayer, but right now, we come before your presence to exalt you. We lift your name up high. You are God on the throne. Lord, there is nobody like you. There is nobody like you. They don't even come close. They're not even in the same category. Lord, you are unique. You are alone. You are high. You are lifted up. Lord, your train fills the temple. Lord, for you to just lean your ears to hear a prayer is just a huge step down, but you so lovingly do it. So we want to exalt you, Lord. We want to exalt you because you have looked upon our lowliness. You've looked upon who we are, and yet you established us. And we want to thank you. We want to give you the praise. Lord, there is nothing else to do but to praise you, to thank you. Lord, to know of what is going on in our city, what is going on in our state, oh Lord Jesus. Prayer blooming everywhere, Lord, like 1,000 daffodils, oh Lord. Father, we are so grateful of what you're doing in the midst of your people. Lord, you're just setting that fire up in the hearts of the people. Lord, I remember on the upper room on the day of Pentecost, oh, suddenly, Lord, the word says, suddenly, and that's what it feels like. All of a sudden, we feel like fire landing upon the hearts and minds and the heads of people. And Father, we are just sitting here amazed to see what you're doing. Father, we thank you, we praise you. Even in this National Day of Prayer, Lord, where the theme has been, exalt the Lord who has established us. Exalt the Lord who has established us. So we want to exalt you. Lord, even as people gather together in different places tomorrow, Lord Jesus, in houses, in parks, in the steps of the state houses, Lord. Lord, in the memorials, in the Cape, Lord, in the Western Mass, Lord, in Northfield, Lord, wherever people are gathering together to pray, Father, I pray that the fire would spread. Lord, this nation would see a revival, O Lord, because your people have learned to exalt you, O Lord, that they put you front and center. They forget about the programs. They forget about fundraising. They forget about other things, but they would put you in front, O Lord. Even this evening, we want to begin by putting you, exalting you, by putting you right on the throne where you belong. Lord, we are happy to be your footstool. We are happy to be a place where your foot can rest. Oh, that's wonderful for us. We are so grateful, Lord Jesus, because you are God alone and you alone are need to be exalted. Father, we thank you. We praise you for this time. In Jesus' name.
Yes, Lord, we thank you for the prayers that are going up, Lord, in faith, Lord, towards you. Lord, we thank you, God, for bringing us to the end of our own selves, our own efforts, Father, and knowing with a surety that without you we can do nothing. And Father, we thank you that prayer is our lifeline. Lord, it is our lifeline to your heart. And Father, we thank you that you are teaching us more and more about your love for us, Lord. And as I've said recently, it is not difficult to be in the presence of someone who loves us. And Lord, you love us. You love us more than any other human being could ever love us. And Lord, we just thank you that hearts are responding to you. Lord, we thank you, God, for what we are hearing, what we are seeing, Lord, in our city of Boston, in the state of Massachusetts, Lord, and we pray your blessing, Lord, the National Day of Prayer upon every community in Massachusetts, Lord. We thank you for people that are gathering together in their local communities, Lord. We thank you for the joy that we can gather together this year, Lord. And that prayers will be going up throughout this state, God. We pray you will bless Angelo, Lord. We thank you for his faithfulness as an intercessor, God. And we thank you for all of those, Lord, who are lifting up your name, who are praising you, Lord, who are believing you, God, for a mighty outpouring of your Holy Spirit throughout this state of Massachusetts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And Father, we're just so thankful that you again are at work, both to will and to do of your good pleasure in our hearts and in the people of this state of Massachusetts. And we pray for all of New England. We thank you, God, that you are at work from Maine all the way down to Pennsylvania and New York and New Jersey. And Lord, we're knowing that you are really wanting to be able to touch our lives. And we're praying, Lord, that tomorrow, as you move upon the hearts of people, that there will be an intentionality to be able to be with you all day long. Lord, I don't know how it's going to be where you are, but I just know that God wants for you to be able to just be aware of him. Even if you have your work to do, even if you have your house to clean, even if you have people to visit, that you just carry the anointing of God with you and you just move in him. In him we move, live and move and have our being. And Lord, we're thanking you that you're going to be moving with every one of us tomorrow all day long. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Angelo, will you share some of the prayer gatherings that you're aware of that are going to be happening?
Yeah, thanks, Charlotte. So this looks like God has just got a lot of people. I'm really not taking any credit for this because God has put it in the hearts of different people. to pray. The last I checked, there are about 20 locations in Mass. There's prayer. And, there's prayer in the morning. There's prayer in front of state houses in some cities. I think in Leominster, there's in the Moody Center. In Northfield, they're kicking off a whole 10 days of social media fast, starting with the National Day of Prayer. Then I think, Charlotte, you mentioned there's going to be prayer, in the memo, in the monument there, right, in the Cape. There's prayer in the Cape. There's prayer everywhere. There are people that are praying online. So if you have time during the day, there's prayer that's going from tonight to next, midnight there. So if you want to join an hour, there's prayer there. It looks like if people want to pray, there's, people are just gathering to pray. And if people want to know what's the closest location for them to gather in person, you can go to the nationaldayofprayer.org. That's the website, /events, right? And hopefully that'll show up at the bottom. So you can go there and you can search, put your city, or you can just say Massachusetts. You can see all of the events that are close by. There's a few special things that I want to talk about. One is in the State House. Right in the front of State House, we're going to gather on the afternoon tomorrow. Pastor Dave Hill would be leading the prayer there, right? And we're hoping to, have a big gathering there as well, right? So that God would come and help with our legislatures, right? We really want to pray for them. The goal here for the National Day of Prayer, and in my heart too, I'm not worried as much about policy. I'm not worried as much about changing people's mind. I'm more worried about praying for those in authority, right? For whatever they want to do. I may not agree with everything that they do, but God has put them above me in a place of power. And I really want to bless them and pray that God would give them all of the blessing that he needs, right? The goal is that they would love Jesus, Otherwise, everything else can change, right? You can have your policy, you can have everything. You love Jesus, we'll be good. Just a quick thought, Brandt, Paul told us to pray for those in authority when those in authority were about to kill him.
Yeah, absolutely.
He wasn't asking for prayer, change their minds, or Lord, deliver us from the Roman Empire. No, he was saying, pray for those in authority,
actually, just to develop that a little bit further, Angelo, the fact of the matter is that, Agabus had come with his hands bound because he had this prophetic word for Paul, and the disciples there in Jerusalem were discouraging him. They were in Jerusalem and they were saying, don't go to Rome. Because, Paul was compelled by the Spirit to go to Rome. And it was not good, the things that were going to happen there in Rome. And ultimately, he did end his life there in Rome. But we know that through that, able to witness, and through that, able to spread the gospel. And sometimes we just have to see that God is working in and through things that we can't understand, because we have this finite understanding of what we think would be favorable, what we think God would want to use. And usually it leads us to a life of luxury. and a life of ease, but that is clearly not how God works. God will lead us into, Jesus said, lead us not into temptation, but God will lead us into troubled spots. He will lead us into difficulties. He will lead us into places of conflict for his glory. And so anyway, I just felt like just a little word about that when you were talking about Paul and that. So continue. I'm sorry for interrupting.
Brandt, now that you're speaking about it, I want to challenge people on one challenge, right? Is that we complain about our politicians. We complain about the problems. Just take how much hours you complain, right? And just equal amount of hours, pray that God would bless them. That's all, right?
Yeah.
I'm learning this, right? As soon as I start complaining about someone, I hear God tell me, did you pray for them? What right do you have to complain? Right? You've not prayed for them. You've not interceded for them. You've not interceded on their behalf and say, Lord, bless them. Right? And then we have no right to complain, right? So I want us to, you know, like as Christians, we say that they don't like us. The politicians don't like us. That's because we don't show the love of God to them. You know, we go complain, we go do all sorts of things. But I want to challenge, right? So write a letter of love to your local legislature and say, we love you. We are praying for you. Tell me what I can pray for. Don't ask for new policy, nothing. Just tell me what I can pray for you. We want to bless you, you know, and let's see how the state moves, you know. And I'm sure they are in a very tough spot. They are in a place where people come to them for favors and we go to them for favors. But, you know, I don't know if there's enough people praying for them. And just telling them, hey, I'm praying for you. We love you. We want you to succeed. Tell me how I can pray for you. I think it's going to change hearts and minds of a lot of our leaders and drive them to Christ. You know, Paul says the love of God constrains me. And let the love of God that flows from our heart constrain them, because we want them to feel the love of God, you know. And I'm sorry, we are going completely out of topic, but I really feel that's what we want to do in the state house, not to go politic, not to go hold flags against people, but to go there and bless each one of those that work there, either whether they're elected officials or whether they're bureaucrats. You know, there's so many people working there. They all need our prayers. So we're going to do that. If you're willing to do, if you want to do that, come join us in the state house or in front of the state house. We're going to pray, and we're praying that God would give us a room inside the state house next year, so that we can be in a place of blessing, and where our feet are there, you know, we would bring the blessing of God on these people, you know. I genuinely don't want to do politics. I genuinely want to pray for the blessing of the people God has put over us.
Angelo, would you share the time for those of us and our friends who are in this Boston area? Would you share the time that people will be gathering at the Boston State House outside?
Around 4 o'clock, Charlotte, it's 4 o'clock is the current plan. But if you go to the /events page, you'll have the latest information along with the exact location in the nationaldayofprayer.org/events, right? That's the right official time would be there. But it's around 4 o'clock tomorrow in front of the State House, right? And we just want to gather and pray. If you don't mind me kind of progressing, and pastors or anybody, right, just go to that site if you want to get involved. Hey, I'm opening my church for 1 hour of prayer for our nation,
right,
and just put it on the site, right, and maybe local people would just come in, just gather and pray. You know, we have the theme, the nationaldayofprayer.org site has got, you know, the 7 mountains you can pray for. There's a program already set. It makes it very easy for you to pray. And in fact, our Governor Charlie Baker, has given a proclamation for our state asking all of us to pray. You know, the next time we complain about government, obey what they're telling us to do when they're telling us to go pray to God. And I really feel we need to take that seriously. You know, we get it every year and it becomes a routine. But it's a proclamation from our governor. He's telling us, hey, pray for our state. We need you guys to pray. And I think, you know, if you're a pastor, if you have a church, open the church up, you know, for 1 hour, put it in the site. You know, people go to that site a lot and, you know, people would come and join. And, you know, maybe you'd meet more Christians that can gather together and continue to pray. You know, this could be a start of something beautiful in our state, you know.
Thank you so much, Angelo. You are always an inspiration to our hearts. And you'll be coming back in just a few moments. But we have another special guest tonight. For those of us who have been around New England for a while, this guest, Louis Arsenault, has a beautiful God-given gift to show up wherever God is moving. And he really is an inspiration to so many of us. I know he's been to my life. And Louis is going to be sharing about the missionary work that he's been doing in Ghana, in Africa. He is leaving in the month of May, I believe it is, Brant, to go back to Ghana. And it's very exciting what God is doing. And in many ways, he, along with others, are really laying down their lives for the people of Ghana, the children of Ghana, and in very concrete ways. So we just want to welcome Louis to our prayer program tonight.
Louis, it's so good to have you here with us in the studio. Thank you for making the time to prioritize coming here and sharing your story. Can you just share with the folk a little bit how you began and with this call of God to do this missions work? It's very exciting, and I'm looking forward to our people getting to know about your work.
Well, it began about 30 years ago when I took my very first mission trip with a local church down in South Florida. I knew that this was something I wanted to do. And over the course of the next 20 years, I went on several different trips to many different countries. But what I saw in the year 2013 was the power of the Jesus film. Those of you that don't know, it's a full-length gospel presentation. It's scripturally accurate. You can literally look at the Bible and read and based on the book of Luke and follow along. It doesn't deviate. It's amazing. But the man who had a vision for this, named Bill Bright, Campus Crusade for Christ, he's now in heaven. His heart cry was that people would hear the gospel in their own heart language. Yeah. A lot of the people can't read in the world. They're not going to learn how to read, so how do you reach them? So when I saw the impact on whole villages of hearing the gospel in their own language, in a language I didn't even know, and seeing them come to Christ was just so powerful. I wanted to do this more. And I remember having a conversation with my pastor, and I said, I wonder how many more villages are out there that don't know. And he says, I don't know. I said, I don't know either, but inside of me, I'm like, I'm going to find out. What if I had my own motorcycle, and I came, and I had a generator, and I could show the Jesus film, and I could stay longer? What would that look like? How?
You know, I just want to ask you about this, because this is a most unusual way that you have of going around and being able to be transport the film and the screen and that. You do this by motorcycle in Africa?
Well, yeah, I've been going back to the same place in Ghana, in the northern region, and the primary vehicle is a motorcycle. Now, when I came with the team, before I became an independent missions ministry myself, we had a big vehicle, and we had a generator and a big screen, and it was real easy when you could throw everything in a big vehicle. Mm-hmm. But to come on my own meant I'd have to figure all this stuff out, how to get from point A to point B. So therein lies the challenge. The generators would be noisy and gasoline-powered and break down. So that was when the idea came. To use a solar panel on the roof of a motorcycle. The solar panel is the roof. So God gave me an idea to design this.
That's amazing.
And I have a picture of it.
Uh-huh.
And you can see.
Yeah.
So the solar panel is the roof. It powers up a battery bank, and that allowed me to go remotely into the villages where there's no power and show the film in their own language. So basically, you're a traveling multimedia show.
So you go in and you store that energy in batteries, correct. But you show the film at night, I'm guessing?
Yes, it has to be at night, correct.
Okay.
Yes.
And you can get through an entire film using a projector, and that's drawing some wattage and some power.
Yes.
To be able to make that all work. Wow,
yeah,
this is really
amazing. It was a challenge to build. It took about 2 years to design this thing and build it and then ship it over to Africa. I don't bring it back and forth, of course.
Uh-huh.
It's a big motorcycle.
Yeah.
Much bigger than the ones they even have there. Most of them are 100 to 200 cc's. This is one of our U.S. 650 cc, what we call a motocross bike, on and off. It can go down the freeway at 70 miles an hour or go on a trail.
Oh.
So that's what I designed.
You can't pack this all on top of a motorcycle. Do you have a trailer with it?
Well, no. I put
this?
It all on one motorcycle, and honestly, the challenge became when I got there. It was great on our roads, but our roads are much different than their roads, so it wasn't really tested well. So with all the weight and how it wasn't balanced the best it could have been, and a little dirt road, a little rain, it became a very
challenging vehicle.
Yeah. So then we had to modify things. Everything was on one vehicle. on one bike, but then we began to travel in convoys where we'd break down some of the equipment and put, you know, the big rigging for the screen, because we can show the film to 500 to 1,000 people. So it's a pretty big screen. We use
just tell me the size of the screen in because we use
it's like feet. 10 feet by 10 feet.
10 feet,
and you can see on both sides of it. So then we had two portable speakers, very powerful powered speakers. So we would take the battery bank. It was a 100-amp-hour battery bank with a 1,000-watt inverter to power everything up. So with 100 amp hours, that's how long you could run it for. We were able to show the film through two full times, but then it's charged by the solar panel, and it would charge the battery bank back up. So that's over the past 6 years, we've been able to found 10 different churches in the little villages, and of course you have to have your leadership in place before you start the church. So you know who the so there's a little more to it than just
there is there
you
really
know
is.
Riding around and mm-hmm. aiming in one village or another. You know, but that is the gist of it. That's how God got me there. And then, you know, the Great Commission is go into all the world and make disciples. So the disciple making is where the work really begins,
right?
To teach and to train. So we began to do conferences. The chief loved what we did so much. Mm-hmm. He gave us land to build upon. So we built a missions house. And now we use that to house missionaries that will come on short-term trips and to teach and train the locals to do the work of the ministry.
Wow, this is really an amazing thing. You started in 2014?
I began to work on the motorbike in 2014. And my former pastor encouraged me to start my own nonprofit, which I founded in 2015. Uh-huh. And then the motorcycle got shipped over in 2016.
Okay, so it's been there, and you've been going back and forth and then using it to go in your outreaches and your ministry and show the film. And I'm guessing you give an altar call and give opportunity for people to respond to
Christ.
Yes,
at the end of the film, it's designed in a way to where you can do that. You could stop it at any point. So I actually went to the Jesus Film headquarters just about 3-4 weeks ago, and they love what I do. You know, so many things in life has changed now in our changing world.
Absolutely.
So they used to have teams that went, but now they don't do it that way. Now they like to find guys like me that are already doing this. Mm-hmm. And the fellow that I went to go meet in leadership, his title was Partnership Accelerator. So he asked me, how can I help? What do you need? So with technology advancing all the time, he said, why don't I give you a whole new kit? It all fits in a backpack. All the same equipment. I can use...
Including the screen?
Well, it's a smaller setup. The target audience is now 1 to 200 people mm-hmm. versus the 500 to 1,000 people. Mm-hmm. But it all fits in 27 pounds in a backpack.
Amazing.
So now I can jump on one bike. I can jump on the back of a bike when somebody else is driving it. Mm-hmm. And it's going to increase our mobility. But also, too, they've taken the Jesus film and they've segmented it into, this really excites me, into 58 different Bible studies where you can teach weekly. So you're going back and you're teaching and training with the film. So you're using the film, and then they've designed a whole curriculum. Mm-hmm. So it's amazing for establishing, as they've even changed the wording from planting a church to establishing a missional community. At week 17, they are encouraged to go out and reach another village. So mm-hmm. it should multiply exponentially. Mm-hmm. So I'm really excited. I'll be going back in about 1 month mm-hmm. on May 17th with the new equipment, with the discipleship curriculum. Really excited to implement this and give to my new guy and train him. And I'll
this
be there.
This is amazing.
It's a lot of fun.
Really, yeah. I could see where it would be very exciting and keep you motivated and keep you going back. And that's really a wonderful thing. I really do want for each of our people to really get a vision for how God can uniquely design some kind of a missional outreach that you can steward. Just like Louis is doing, he's doing it in Africa, but it doesn't necessarily have to happen in Africa. There's different ways that God can work and begin to ask the Lord, what might you do? And use your imagination, but obviously really present it before the Lord and before the leadership of your church and whatever, so you're not just like a lone ranger running out there and mm-hmm. trying to save the world, because that never works. But God's doing this. He's preparing people to be able to take the gospel in new and interesting ways. So, Louis, just share a couple more thoughts, and then, because this is our prayer meeting and we do this on Wednesday nights, as you know, and we'll be wanting to pray for you specifically, but we also are wanting to pray for a release of the kingdom through many different strategies and methods. Methods always change, but the message is the same, that Jesus is the Lord and Savior, and we need to have every knee bow, every tongue confess Jesus Christ as Lord.
Amen.
So just share with us, and then we're going to pray.
I would like to encourage you to look at, we just established a new website at mm-hmm. johnsheart.net.
Okay.
But if you want to see how we began, it's freedommoto.org. That'll show pictures of the motorcycle and a couple videos we did back in 2017 was the last one I did. That's when we broke ground and began to build the missions house. But I want to encourage you to look at this first and allow God to, He wants to dream through you.
Mm.
He wants to give you the dream. And if it's a dream from God, it's really His dream. He's just
right.
putting it, the seed in you.
Saddle up your horses.
He doesn't love any one of us more than another.
Mm-hmm.
I've only seen two of these things, the one I have in the U.S. and the one I have there. It's a crazy idea, but if it's what God wants, He'll speak to us. Each one of us are so unique. We're like a snowflake. Every fingerprint is different. Every snowflake is different.
Yeah.
And God will use you with the abilities He's given you, natural abilities. And hopefully looking at what God's given me to do and seeing how it actually works. At the beginning, people were kind of like, this is kind of out of the box for me. And my former pastor was engineer, yeah. former engineer. So he had the engineering mind. So it didn't exactly fit in his box straight away.
Yeah, yeah.
But now that we've come a long ways and we have results, it's different. But God will stretch you and challenge you. But he wants to use you in all that you are. And I'm just honored to be here to be able to share this with what God's given me to do.
Well, like I said, I really do want for us to remember that this is a prayer meeting and for us to do that work of prayer. And we want to pray, allow me to pray first, and then you go ahead and pray as well. But Father, we just ask that by your Holy Spirit, you will give your vision, your dream to each and every person who has an aspiration of doing something for you. And I believe, Lord, that each individual who really makes you the Lord of their lives pursues you and desires to be able to find what it is that they have been created to do, what task they have been assigned to accomplish. And Father, we just know that it's always mysterious, but it's not beyond us. It's not beyond what we can do. You never call us to do something that is beyond the measure of our calling or the measure of our gifting. Lord, it falls within the scope of what you have put into us, in our nature, in our imagining, in our capability, in our creativity. And Father, I pray that we will be able to just move into that with a sense of joy in our hearts, without striving, without forcing, without being overwhelmed with the responsibilities that we are assuming, so that, Lord, you're able to lead us by your Spirit. You're able to accomplish in and through us the very thing that you've designed us to do. Lord, I thank you for Louis. I thank you for his calling, and we pray blessing upon him even as he prepares to go on this next journey to Africa, again with his motorcycle and this new gear to be able to reach out to a new set of peoples. So Father, we just praise you for that, and we ask your blessing upon him. And Louis, you just go ahead and just pray.
Thank you, Lord. Father, I just thank you for each eye and ear who is taking this program in. I pray that the excitement you've given me, the passion you've given me, somehow is imparted through my words, through what they can learn and glean from what you've given me to do, Lord. And you begin to give them a passion and a hunger to reach people however you've designed them to be used, Lord God. I thank you, Lord God, that you want to use each one of us, every one of us. Lord, I pray that you would help each one to step out in faith. Yes. And Lord, I thank you that you meet us. You say that we are to live by faith. The just will live by faith, it says in your Holy Bible, Lord God. Father, I thank you, Lord God, that you chose us. Yes. You handpicked each one of us. And you have a place and a plan for each one of us, our destiny. Lord, help us all to be able to walk into that destiny. Give us courage. We come against any kind of fear.
Yes.
Lord God, the Apostle Paul, as much as you used him, so many times we hear people say, I want to be like Paul. He had to pray for boldness, even twice in one prayer in the book of Ephesians. So I pray for boldness for my brothers and sisters watching right now. You'd give them boldness to step into and move towards what you are putting in their heart, Lord God.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord God. Help them to fulfill the destiny you have for them, Lord God.
Yeah.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you,
Lord. Amen. Amen. And now we'll just go back to the rest of our program that's happening in the studio.
We want to thank Louis for being with us and for sharing his burden for the people of Ghana and all that God is doing. We just bless you, Louis. And in our final moments, we're going to return and bring back Angelo Rajadurai. And Angelo, we talked a lot earlier in the program about Massachusetts, But I know that it's broader than, you know, it's called the National Day of Prayer. So it's throughout our nation. But particularly if you could share with us what God is doing in the New England states as well, in a regional sense.
Thank you, Charlotte. That's a wonderful thing. There's a lot of events going on in the nation. There's going to be a national broadcast tomorrow, right? And that's going to be broadcast in many TV stations in the U.S. and in Europe. But specifically in the Northeast, God is doing beautiful things, you know, right from Maine all the way down to New Jersey and Pennsylvania. All the nine states, there's a lot of wonderful events going on. Again, that same site that I gave you, nationaldayofprayer.org/events, you know, you can put your local location and find out. You know, there are, you know, beautiful things. There are people in the state houses that went and asked for, I think in New Hampshire, this is what happened. They said, hey, I want some piece of land. They said, oh, please take two. You know, why don't you have this as well for prayer? So they're going to have music and prayer going on. You know, so it's God is moving beautifully in the lives of in and through people. And I want to highlight Connecticut, right? Sheila Kimball, who's the state coordinator for Connecticut, saw a dream when she started this where there was, I think, a birthday cake with a picture of Connecticut with candles, you know, in every city. And God put it in her heart saying, I want prayer in every city. And she now, for the last, I think, 10 years, they've had prayer, National Day of Prayer events in every city.
Wow.
You know, so I Connecticut is just our neighbor, you know, so we
they're our neighbor, they're ahead of us in some things, and New Hampshire is way ahead in some things, yeah. You know, because they're so coordinated, and they've really labored together and learned to love each other and get through some of the stressors, because, you know, when people and churches in our humanity, you know, we run into roadblocks and we bump our heads into problems and sometimes each other, you know. I mean, sometimes you see these bighorn sheep, you know, out on the mountains and they're banging heads and it feels like the body of Christ sometimes has that kind of an experience. But we know that God works beyond all of those things, and this is really what he's doing. I would just like to take the next few minutes to just really begin to pray with our people who are watching, and we really want to encourage you to take these moments now and be very specific in prayer, especially for tomorrow, that your heart would be prepared and that God would really use this as an occasion and an opportunity to really influence your close family, your close relatives. There are people like some of us who are really praying for family members that are going through difficulties and challenges. And so we really want to pray. We are praying for the nation. It is the National Day of Prayer, but there is that which is personal and then that which is corporate. And we really want to touch all of these things. God knows. He understands it all. And he's going to watch over this. And so, Charlotte, would you begin to pray? And then, Angelo, I'm going to ask you to pray, and then I'll kind of follow up, and we'll be pretty close to our closing time at the end of that, dear. Go ahead.
Lord, tomorrow, would you do something so special throughout our nation? Lord, I pray that you would bring our nation to its knees. And Father, we recognize that we as your people, we are the ones responsible to humble ourselves, to seek your face, to turn from our wicked ways. And you have promised that you will hear from heaven and you will heal our land. And Lord, these are not empty words at all. This is your word. These are your promises, God. And as we fulfill these conditions, Lord, you, your heart, God, is turned towards us. And we stand in the gap, Lord, for our nation, this nation of America, Lord, that is just so torn and divided right now. Father, we need, Lord, just a deluge of your love and of your presence and of the reality of your power, Father. And so we lift up throughout our nation, God, the prayer that will be going up, Lord, all day long tomorrow, into the evening hours as well, God. And we ask, Lord, that you truly would hear from heaven and you would heal our land, Lord. We pray for Massachusetts, especially, God. We ask, Lord, that you continue, God, to bring reconciliation and unity of your body, Lord. Help us to recognize our great need of you and our great need of one another, Lord. And this has been some of the keys, as was mentioned, of why Connecticut and New Hampshire have been leading the way, because they have recognized, Lord, that they need one another too, in your body. And so, Father, I pray you would just continue to bring us together more in Massachusetts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lord, you're just laying it in my heart to pray for Brother Louis and his trip to Ghana, Lord. I really felt led to just pray for him, Lord. We pray that you bless him, Lord. You just protect him, and where he goes, just let him be a light, Lord. And you teach him how to talk to various people, and Lord, and you would continue to bless him, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, because he's taking your light from this state and traveling back to the uttermost part of the world, and we are grateful for that. And Father, we also come to you to pray for this event that you've planned for us and has been sanctioned by our governor and the president and the whole nation, Lord. You've called to pray. So we come before you that we will begin to exalt you, Lord, that we will be grounded and rooted in love, that we would reflect your love to the people, Lord, that we wouldn't just compromise with the world. No, Lord, not, that's not what I'm asking for, but we would take a stand for you, but we would do it in love. That people would call us Christians and they would know we are Christians by our love. Lord, that would be the reflection, even as we are lifting the Lord of love above everything else in our state, Lord Jesus. And even as we are rooted and grounded in the doctrines, if we are rooted and grounded in orthodoxy, we also want to be rooted and grounded in love. Lord Jesus, Lord, we don't want to compromise on anything else, but we want to show your love to people. Lord, when you were on this earth, you just like showed love like nobody else has. People like little kids to the poor, to the sick, to the sinners, Lord, anybody could just come to you and feel your love. Lord, we want to become a reflection of you even as we lift you up. Lord, we pray for the various events that are happening in our state tomorrow. We pray for those who are leading it. Lord, I pray that you would protect them. Lord, that as they pray, that they would see you move in their own lives, in the lives of their churches, in the lives of their community, right from the city hall to the schools, Lord, to the emergency rooms, to the fire stations, to the police departments, to the hospitals. Lord, everywhere that your word would go, that we wouldn't just imprison you in our churches, but we would let your love flow out, Lord Jesus, to every part of reality in our state. Lord, we thank you because you're putting that into the hearts of the people that are listening right now. Lord, I pray that you encourage people to begin to pray for those who are in authority. Lord, that we might lead a quiet and a peaceable life, that your gospel would spread like wildfire in our state. Lord, that they would say that the first great awakening, second great awakening is not to be compared to the awakening of 2022. Lord, that would be what we want to hear, because you are closer. Your coming is closer today than it was when the first great awakening happened, O Lord. So we pray that right now that you would send that and it would permeate into our societies, O Lord Jesus. That would be a transformation of our state, that you would bring a blessing into our state because your people bend their knees, pray and lift you up, O Lord. We thank you for this time. Encourage each one of us, Lord, to come out openly in public to pray and to lift their hands, to worship you, to lift you up, and to show your love one to another. We thank you, we praise you, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Father, we just thank you for this time that we've had to be around this table in prayer. And I thank you, Lord, that you're blessing your people right now. We thank you, Father, for this house, this congregation, Lion of Judah, that you have given us the privilege of being a part of, a body of people who are in pursuit of you. We thank you, Lord, that you are working and you are going to continue to work. We do want to pray literally across the globe. We pray in particular for Ukraine and those pastors over there who are really using every opportunity to declare and to proclaim your grace in that land that is war-torn now. But Father, we thank you that you are blessing us as we go from this place. And we know, Lord, that you're going to make tomorrow powerful for each and every one of us. God bless you, and we look forward to seeing you again on another Wednesday night next week. When you come to your churches, wherever you go to church, we welcome you here at Lion of Judah, but we know that there are many places to serve the Lord, and we pray blessing upon your house of worship and the place where you gather. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you.